The Black Studies program at Cleveland State University welcomes you to this season of Image It, a public affairs radio forum dedicated to open dialogue on a variety of diverse topics of interest and issues of concern, which focus on the life and experiences of African Americans and all peoples of African descent. By visiting our website at www.csuohio.edu/blackstudies and clicking on the Images link, you can view upcoming shows and listen to past guests. Now here is your host for Images.
Looking ahead to the coming elections, the following is a special presentation sponsored by the Cleveland State University Black Studies Program.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
Althea, Althea, Althea Perry, what are you doing up here reading? Put that paper down. We're waiting for you so we can go to church together.
Damn this war. Now I would have to become a school teacher. Not that I really minded teaching, but in Paris or London or Rome. Not here, not lost in the Cumberland Mountains. I wanted to go to Europe. I wanted to be an expatriate like those people I had read about, like Ernest Hemingway and Richard Wright. I wanted to sit in Gertrude Stein's living room and meet Matisse and Picasso. I wanted the life of the artiste, a life above politics. But the war changed all that. After 4 years of college and a tour last Easter of every art museum in New York City, I had come home to stay in Three Forks, Virginia, where nothing ever happens. Nothing. Or so I thought.
Thank you, brothers and sisters. In the days to come, we need to know that God abides with us all. And before we leave here today, Brother Henry has a few words to say to us all. Brother Henry?
You wait for me outside, Althea.
Yes, Papa. I watched my grandfather climb the 4 short steps to the altar. He stood there for a moment, towering above the podium. He let his eyes sweep over the crowd, then he rocked back on his heels and stuck his thumbs beneath his suspender straps. He always did that before a speech, and the longer he did that, the longer the speech.
Brothers and sisters, maybe to you this morning that place they call Hawaii might seem a long way away. And it is, as far as I know, but then I've never been there, and I don't plan to go. Because when you get to be my age, you know well enough to just stay put. No, sir. I won't be going to Hawaii or Japan or any place else to fight. In this war or any other. Fact is, I'm too old to fight in wars. I was too old for the last war and too young to fight in the one before that. But just because a man's never been in a war don't mean he's not a soldier. No, sir. You women neither. We're all soldiers all the time. God's soldiers, and we fight the same war.
Amen, amen, brother. Yes.
And just because most of us never been any more past Kingsport don't mean we don't know the world. We know the world. We know our people can be, And y'all know what I'm talking about.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
Oh, no. He's going to get them started now. This could go on for hours, and I'm starving. Grandpa, please.
That's right, brothers and sisters. We are soldiers of the world right here in Three Forks, Virginia. We don't need to go to Hawaii to know about people that's been killed while they sleep or had their homes burnt to the ground.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
This Hitler is a threat to the world, sure enough, but he's a special threat to us colored folks in America.
Negroes, Papa. We are Negroes now.
This idea of a superior race is nothing new to any of us. It's a notion everyone in this room fights against every day of his life. Why, sometimes I wonder if colored people weren't put on this earth to remind the world that all God's children are brothers under the skin.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen. Yes. Praise yes. The Lord.
In fact, I wonder sometimes if colored people aren't God's own chosen people.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
An entire race to prove God's love. To show we can stand the test of Job.
Preach it,
preach it.
Amen.
I squirmed against the side of the pew. I hated these displays of moving spirit. I didn't believe God likes people yelling in his house any more than Grandma did in hers.
Now, I've got nothing against the Japanese myself. Never saw one, and as far as I know, none of them has ever seen me. But when they make plans to take over this country, they're making plans to take me over.
Oh, Grandpa, you don't understand. If you ever saw the art, you'd like the Japanese. Why, in the 6th century, they made dolls exactly like the one blind Jean made for me before he lost the one good eye he had. Dolls that were rough and tender at the same time.
Yes, sir, brothers and sisters. It's a plan to take us all over. 2 steps forward, 100 years behind. And you know we soldiers have come too far to let that happen.
Praise the Lord, brother.
Amen to that, brother.
Why did Grandpa stay here anyway? He didn't belong in this one-horse town. He should have left years ago. I looked at his face. His hair was as white as the button-down collar that cut into his chin. Grandma starched it stiff as a board every Monday after church. He hated that collar. It didn't seem to bother him now, though. He just went on and on about the war and what it would mean to the colored community of Three Forks.
Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war.
Soldiers, always soldiers. Grown men ready to fight side by side in a war before they'll live together in peace. I thought about the recruitment lines at the post office. There stood my brother, Felix, laughing and joking with Joe Fleener like they used to when they were kids. Laughing like his sister, Maylene, and I used to do in the summer. I remember how much fun we had before Grandma told me I couldn't do that sort of thing, have white kids for friends.
It's for your own good, Althea, for both you and Maylene. There can't be no more about it. You just can't run around these parts with that girl. Now stop that sniffling and go set the table.
I watched the rest of the men in line. No one made my brother get out of it or give up his place to a white man. What a rib! Generations of racial prejudice set aside for the singular purpose of defeating the art-loving Japanese. The room was quiet. Grandpa was drumming his fingers against the railing like he does when he's going to make a point.
Brothers and sisters, the date the president says will live in infamy can also be known as the date that colored people in America come forth to prove to the world once and for all that America is our home and that colored boys are willing to fight for it. As most of you know, my grandson, Felix, was one of the first of our boys to enlist. They tell me he practically camped out on the post office steps.
Amen.
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 All right.
There they go again. My stomach began to growl. I was so hungry I could practically taste the supper my grandma would make after church. That ham, those green beans, the corn she canned last fall. I stared into space and thought about supper. If it weren't for this war, I could go to Paris and open a restaurant. I could use my grandma's recipes. Mais oui, mes amis, more cornbread, more wine. Yeah, southern cooking in Paris. They like that kind of thing in the avant-garde.
The president has declared tomorrow, Monday, as the Bill of Rights Day. So we can all take a day to remember that. No matter how bad things can get here, they could be worse off somewhere else. And if you want to know what I think, brothers and sisters, I think that the colored folks of Three Forks should use this day to show Maxfield County and the state of Virginia what we think of this threat to our freedom, the freedom that's coming to us, the freedom to have a say in how things will be once the world knows that colored people will not be denied. I think, brothers and sisters, that tomorrow we ought to turn out in record numbers and register to vote. Now, I know that some of you know what this means, but I also know that every one of you in this room old enough to vote knows the Bill of Rights by heart, learned it in the fourth grade, and I know you know it because my wife patted it into you. Brother Reginald knows it. Look at him sitting up here, one of the youngest deacons, a good man. But my ma told me about how he stuffed a chair pillow down his pants. Yeah, she told me. Tried to get out of memorizing the Bill of Rights, didn't you, Brother Reginald? Look at him up here. Look at him. We got him squirming now.
I was starting to doze, but the laughter woke me up. That and the long, loud rumble that echoed through my empty stomach. I wondered if Grandpa could still be talking about the war.
But he learned them, Brother Reginald did, and he uses them even today. Brothers and sisters, I'm not asking you to do anything that I'm not asking myself or my own, except for Althea, who just came back from college up there in Ohio. Everybody in my family is registered to vote. And just this morning, she said to me, Papa, I'm just as much an American as Felix.
What? What did I say?
Then she told me that she was going to be the first one in line on Monday, ready to register and do her part for America. She said she'd be ready with her papers in her hand.
Papers? What papers? What is he talking about? There was no time to say anything. The music started. I watched Grandpa leave the podium. Before he was at the back door, people were all around me, patting my hand, pinching my cheeks. I couldn't get up. Praise the Lord, they said. Bless you, they said. I didn't know what to do. How was I going to tell them I never said any such thing? That my grandpa was telling them lies, that I hadn't the slightest idea what he was talking about.
Established in 1969, the Black Studies program of Cleveland State University is currently comprised of 6 instruments used to implement the program's mission to contribute knowledge, promote understanding, and to share with all generations and all cultures the rich legacy of the African diaspora. First, there is the academic program, an interdisciplinary curriculum of nearly 80 courses offering a major and minor in Black Studies. The Howard A. Mims African American Cultural Center is open to the public and features art exhibits, programs, a colloquium series, panel discussions, and roundtables. The Lecture Art and Media series brings international, national, and local speakers, artists, and films to the campus. Images, a public affairs radio forum, interviews guests from many fields of endeavor. The Jazz Heritage Orchestra is a professional 17-piece orchestra comprised of musicians who are also educators officially in residence at CSU. The Jazz Heritage Orchestra is dedicated to preserving and perpetuating the musical heritage of the great African-American jazz master.
Lord, Brother Henry, don't the time just fly? I look at you, Althea, and remember all those questions you used to ask when you were little. Miss Louisiana this and Miss Louisiana that. You was always talking. Always. Wasn't she, Brother Henry?
Mm-hmm.
And I can picture always having to holler at you and Ethel Ann by running through the house on Sundays. At your age, I used to say. Now look at you, all growed up. Both of you, young ladies. Ethel Ann ought to be finished with school this spring. And when she comes home, I'm going to have her do the same thing as you, Althea. Well, I'll be turning off now. That was a moving speech, Brother Henry. We should see some results on this one.
Yes, well, I had to start somewhere, I reckon. Afternoon, sister.
Let me give you a hug, Althea, honey. We all are so proud of you, Althea. So many of the young ones don't come back no more, let alone come back and get involved.
No, ma'am. I mean, yes, ma'am.
Now you get. Go catch up with your grandpa there. Y'all say hello to Miss Maud now. You'll do fine, Althea. Don't you worry about nothing.
I stood there and watched Miss Louisiana walk down the street for a minute. I felt so sad. I'd known Ethel Ann all my life. She hated Three Forks. She wrote me a letter before I left Oberlin. She was going straight to California as soon as she finished college. She did not want to come home, not even for a visit. I started off toward Grandpa. The collar was still around his neck, still rubbing into his skin. I didn't understand it. By now, it usually flapped like a bird from its back button as soon as Miss Louisiana turned down the road. Now, she was no longer in sight, and he still kept it on. We walked down the street together.
I had to do it, Althea. It's this war. This war is going to change things for all of us, and we have to be ready. People need examples, Althea. Whether they know it or not, they need to follow it first. Can you understand that?
No! I wanted to scream. No, I don't understand. And I don't want to set any examples in Three Forks, Virginia, either. There's a world out there. I wanted to tell him, but I couldn't. How could I tell him that I hated the very place he had helped to build? I was ready to burst into tears when I noticed he had stopped walking. I looked at my grandfather's face. His jaws were clamped tight, and the toothpick he had in his mouth jerked from side to side between his lips. His eyes stared straight ahead. That's when I saw the black Ford. The car had been parked in front of our house, a half a block away. It moved slowly up the street and rolled to a stop beside my grandfather. Papa?
Not now, Althea.
Afternoon, Uncle Martin. Y'all just about ready?
I'd never seen this man before. He leaned his head from the window. His eyes were hidden beneath a brown felt hat. I saw my grandpa kind of nod. Then he threw his toothpick on the ground.
Y'all better get in on the passenger side.
I walked Grandpa to the other side of the car. The man on the passenger side touched his hat to me and stood there, watching as my grandpa tried to find some dignified way to fold his 6-foot-3-inch frame into the small space of the back seat.
There's still gonna be one more.
The driver turned left down the street to Miss Louisiana's. I watched the tar paper that covered her house loom up, then disappear as we headed for a dirt road at the end of the street. The man on the passenger side played with the dial on the car radio. The road ran beside the creek next to someone's cornfields. I didn't know where we were headed. I'd never been this way before. The men in front never turned around. Grandpa just looked ahead. I stared out of the window. For some reason, I couldn't stop thinking about Blind Jean and his dolls. I always thought my doll was blind, so I never played with it. Then I remembered that none of the dolls he had made had real eyes. Just empty spaces with no circles or marks inside. And it went that way for a while. And then, suddenly, the car pulled off to the right. We bounced along until the car finally stopped. Then the man on the passenger side opened the car.
Y'all better get out here, Uncle Martin. This in here'll stay with you. I'll be back directly.
The man on the passenger side got out of the car. He moved the seat for Grandpa, then he signaled for me to follow. The sky was cloudy. The once warm day now had the chill of early winter. I watched the driver turn the car around and drive back the way he had come. I started to walk back toward the creek when the man on the passenger side called for me to stop.
We'll be moving again, little lady. Don't you go nowhere.
I kept my back to the car. I knew my face would show the annoyance I felt. Who does he think he is, anyway? Stupid hayseed. Why, he would be laughed right out of New York City. They would laugh him right out of Harlem. Harlem. That's where I would go. I would stay until the war was over. I'll live in one of those grand row houses around Lenox and 125th Street. Why, the Negroes there live in better homes than this man would ever see in his life. This was ridiculous, honestly. How could they expect me to settle for Three Forks after I had seen how well people lived in places like Harlem? I heard footsteps behind me. I thought it was Grandpa, but before I could move, something covered my eyes.
You just close your eyes, little lady, and stay where you are.
I tried to move, but something was holding my head.
I said for you to just stay where you are.
I felt a hand on my left elbow. Then I heard my grandpa's voice.
I'm right here, Althea. I'll be with you all the time.
I winced as I felt the knot being tied at the back of my head. The blindfold was tight. I touched it with my right hand. It felt smooth and soft, like a thick cotton pad. It was soft, but firm. I moved my fingers over the surface. It was long and thin and rectangular. It felt familiar, like a Kotex. Oh, God. It couldn't be. The blindfold was a sanitary napkin. Papa, I can't. Papa, is this a...
You just hold on there, little lady. I'll say when you can talk.
I could feel Grandpa squeezing my elbow, and I could tell by the man's tone of voice that this was no time to argue. I could hear the car in the distance. I turned my head away from the sound. I didn't want anyone to see me this way.
Get them others back on in here. This one here's ready to go. All right, little lady. You can get back in now. You too, boy. Uncle Martin.
I felt Grandpa's hand lead me straight to the car. It occurred to me as I stumbled through the doorway that he was able to see. But I didn't have time to wonder why I was the only one blindfolded. Someone else was in the back seat now. There was barely any room. I felt the weight of the car shift as my grandpa got in beside me. I sat there in the middle, with my legs cramped over the footrest. I felt as stiff as a board, squeezed between two thighs that seemed as solid as tree trunks. I couldn't tell where we were going, but it wasn't back to the dirt road. The ground was rough and uneven. I felt myself bobbing around in the back seat, trying not to touch anyone. Something was different, though. Something else besides a man was in the back seat this time. A smell I recognized. An artist's smell. It reminded me of college. Not turpentine, but gasoline. My heart froze. Every horror story my parents had tried to keep from me flashed through my mind. The car stopped. I could feel my heart in my throat. I heard a voice outside the car.
Got them ready?
Yeah, they're tired, ready to go.
I felt a knee push into my left leg. I heard someone fall against the car seat.
Hey, yeah, shut up over there, we'll do it for you.
It's all right. We just got one here, ain't no dancer, that's all.
I didn't know what to feel more, anger or fear. Then Grandpa put my hand in his and guided me outside. I could hear people moving around me. It was cold now. I ducked my chin into my chest. I discovered that if I kept my head down and strained my eyelids against the blindfold, I could see a tiny patch of ground through the space between my nose and the blindfold. Then we started to walk. The ground felt lumpy and soft like newly turned earth. I could feel the heels of my shoes sinking in the soft dirt. I watched my right foot disappear, leaving tracks I would never see.
Step up. Come on. Let's get this over with.
The pressure at my elbow guided me up three steep stairs. We were inside something now. It couldn't be a barn. It was too thin, too drafty. A curing shed, maybe.
Bring him first.
The smell of gasoline began to fade. Nobody moved. Silence hung in the air. It was so thick I could feel it. I could even smell it. It smelled like my grandfather, like mothballs and wool. My throat hurt. I was choking on silence and fear. I wanted to cry, to move, anything. I wanted to open my eyes. I wanted to look at the place I might not ever see again.
You're next, little lady.
Grandpa moved my elbow. My legs felt like wood. He helped me down 2 short steps. We were outside again. The wind was blowing now. I felt it brush against my legs.
Her poll tax been paid?
Poll tax? Poll tax is illegal.
I got it right here. Now, girlie, you're here to take a test to prove to the state of Virginia that you know enough about this country to vote in it.
So that's it. It all began to make sense. People's reaction in church, Miss Louisiana's encouraging words. Everybody knew about this, everybody but me. But why didn't I know? How could I have been so stupid?
Now, if you can pass this test, you can register to vote. If you can't...
Register? Register for what? Register to be frightened to death? If this is what happened when I register, what happens to me when I vote?
Hey, you there, girly. I said, do you or do you not know the Bill of Rights of the United States of America? Tell me now, because if you don't know it, you can't pass this test. And if you don't pass this test, you can't get your papers. And if you can't get your papers, then you can't register. It's as simple as that. Now, do you or do you not know the Bill of Rights?
My anger outdistanced my fear. My head felt light. I couldn't believe it. This was like some kind of joke. Do you? I wanted to scream at this man. Do you know what the Constitution guarantees me? Don't you know that I have rights? Then I felt Grandpa's hand at my elbow. All of a sudden, it did make sense. I raised my head to the voice in front of me. Of course I know the Bill of Rights. Doesn't everyone? Amendment 1. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances.
The story of Althea Perry is a story for us all. Voter suppression and voter intimidation is as real as a billboard in our neighborhood. Voting is a right we can never take for granted, and to vote is a privilege that should never be ignored. Vote in every election.
You have been listening to Images, a public affairs radio program produced by the Cleveland State University Black Studies Program and the station. The opinions expressed today were those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect those of Cleveland State University, the Black Studies Program, or this station. We hope you have enjoyed the music performed by the Jazz Heritage Orchestra. If you are interested in finding out more about the Black Studies Program, call 216-687-3655 or visit our website at www.csuohio.edu/blackstudies.